Warm welcome to all of you on this World Universal Health Day coverage. The India-Africa Health Summit 20 is a first-of-its-kind landmark event curated with the aim of fostering south-to-south collaboration between the healthcare industries of Africa and India with the objective of achieving universal health coverage. NATHEALTH and the Africa Healthcare Federation have organized this summit to address some of the critical issues in the healthcare sector, emphasizing on the fact that organizations and federations across Africa, India, and other countries need to collaborate to find suitable and to make universal health coverage a reality. This summit will also chalk out the path in transforming the healthcare trajectories of India and Africa through effective partnership. We have several dignitaries attending the summit today. I would like to welcome our chief guests, Dr. Ashwajit Singh, Honorable Union Minister of Health and Family Welfare, Science and Technology and Earth Sciences Government of India, and Chairman WHO Executive Board, Her Excellency Amira El-Fadl, Commissioner for Social Affairs, Africa Union Commission, our keynote speakers, Honorable Dr. Nira Thadassa, Minister of Health Ethiopia, Shri V. Muralidharan, Honorable Minister of State for External Affairs, Government of India, our special address speakers, His Excellency Alam Tashira Ulmaria, the Dean of African Missions in India, Shri Rajesh Bhushan, Union Health Secretary, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. I would also like to welcome Shri Rahul Chhabra, Secretary, Economic Relations, Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India, who will also be the chair of the technical session during the summit today. Ms. Preeta Reddy, President of NATHEALTH, the Vice President, Chairperson of Apollo Hospital, Dr. Amit Thakkar, President of Africa Healthcare Federation and Executive Chairman, Africa Health Business, Ms. Claire Omashe, Vice President, AHF and President, Africa Healthcare Federation, and Dr. Harsh Mahajan, Senior Vice President, NATHEALTH, who is also the Founder and Chief Radiologist at Mahajan Imaging, Dr. Ian Clark, Chairman, International Medical Group, Uganda, Dr. Pratap C. Reddy, Founding President, NATHEALTH and Chairman, Apollo Hospitals, Dr. Rana Mehta, Healthcare Industry Leaders and Partner at PwC India, Mr. Ashwajit Singh, Founder and Managing Director, IPA Global, and Mr. Kaustubh Basu, Director, PwC. Senior representatives from multilateral development agencies, Mr. Biju Mohan Das, Principal Investment Officer, International Finance Corporation, Mr. M. Hari Menon, Country Director, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, India, and Ms. Sangeeta Patel, Director, Health Office, USAID, India Mission. The past presidents from the two federations, NATHEALTH and AHF, governing board members, government representatives, diplomats, summit knowledge partners, PwC, IPE Global, media partners, NewsX, HealthWiz Insights, communications partner Avon V, event partner India Attitude, friends and colleagues from the media, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for joining us today. Now, we will start with our inaugural plenary session. For the welcome address, I would like to invite Ms. Preeta Reddy, President of NATHEALTH and the Vice Chairperson of Apollo Hospitals, to give the welcome address.
Namaste, and thank you all for being with us today. My co-members at NATHEALTH, the co-chairs, Amit, the representatives from the wonderful, wonderful continent of Africa. I'm truly honored by everyone's presence, your excellencies, our keynote speakers, Minister, Secretary of Health, the Dean. You know, the list is really a list of luminaries. And for us, NATHEALTH, which is like a very young organization, we're only 7 years old, I think it's very heartwarming to see the kind of response we have, to kind of have the speakers who willingly given up their time. And for some of those who could not be here but who gave the time, like our Honorable Health Minister from both sides, I'm truly grateful for the time and effort, because I think the message really goes a long way in providing the kind of impetus, passion for us to do even more. Why are we even thinking of doing something like this? I think in today's world, all of us have, the best laid plans have been thrown completely out the window because of what has happened with the pandemic. And having said that, I think as a race, humanity is looking to come back stronger, collaborate more, and innovate even better. And I think that is the reason for us to even talk to each other and try and see how jointly can we do so much better. We all know and understand that education and health is a fundamental right. And today, we have all realized that health actually takes a precedence about everything else. So I think the thought that the Federation has come together with NATHEALTH, to me, is extremely significant. It may be a small step today, but it's the beginning of a long journey. It's the beginning of an exciting journey, and it's the beginning of a very committed journey. NATHEALTH, when we started 7 years ago, was really an organization which brought together people from all aspects of healthcare. I am so proud that in 7 years, with the hard work of all the leadership and of the team at the Secretariat, very ably led by Siddhartha, it today has become a powerful voice for the entire healthcare ecosystem. They have been leaders speaking to us, they have been partnerships, meaningful engagements, and I think expanding our horizon is definitely the right step and in the right direction. Doing this with the African subcontinent, to me, is probably the best thing which could have happened, because we all know and understand that by 2050, if we combine the populations between India and Africa, we will actually be the strongest force. And by being the strongest force comes a big responsibility. Comes the responsibility of how will we serve humanity even better. Comes with the responsibility that with the onset of disease, like we've all learned now, can we really handle it quicker, faster? Can we use artificial intelligence to predict the onset of what could possibly go wrong? Could we collaborate and innovate to see that the research is really the cornerstone of anything which we do? Can we really collaborate and innovate? And at this point, look at innovation which is not inward-looking, but innovation which is open innovation. And open innovation is innovation which really brings together the best in class to deliver as quickly as we can for the need of humanity. We have seen what is happening now with the vaccine, and I think that again is a learning for all of us, that you know, if we can really compress the time it takes to produce a vaccine and keep it ready, we've come a long way as humanity. The challenge might be now on the delivery and on the production, but again, by collaboration, by really using resources which are available in multiple sectors, that can be overcome. And then the last mile comes from really creating a very skilled workforce. And I think that is where both of us can work together, partner together, to see how can we train each other to really bring out the best and the most skilled workforce, which will serve our own needs within our country, but which can also serve global needs. With this in mind, we actually spoke together, deliberated, and Amit and his team have given a lot of time to this, along with, you know, Dr. Mahajan, who will be taking. And I must acknowledge the fact that, you know, the government has been extremely supportive with their time, with their thought, with their efforts, and with their energies. And the same thing I know is happening to the African nation. So if these two great countries, which are really going to impact with health outcomes in the rest of the world, if we can come together and if we can really make it, we can never say that we will be 100% future-proof. But if we can lay down ideas, thoughts, and systems for the future, I think it will be a great responsibility, but a step, as I said earlier, in the right direction. And I think today's conference aims to do things like that. We have set up task forces, which will talk about skilling, which will talk about infrastructure, which will talk about manufacturing, and it will also talk about, you know, how can both of us be able to treat our patients better. So if somebody comes to India, can the medical value tourism be so much better for them? And when they go back, you will be a continuum of care. Similarly, can teams from India actually go and train and provide healthcare wherever it's needed in the African nation? And in today's world, when we are talking to people across the globe, just, you know, virtually, constantly, I think all this is possible. The learnings have become much quicker, much nimbler, and much faster. And I think that the future looks bright because we have learned and we've come through so well during the tough times. And the future, I think, depends on us. It depends on us delegating the way we are. It depends on the support which we've been getting constantly from both our governments, and I really would like to thank them for that. So I think the future of health depends on the directions and on the decisions we take today. And this is going to be a journey which is a journey of togetherness, a journey of innovation, and a journey which will really be able to give back to humanity. Thank you all for being with us together on this journey, willingly collaborating and giving up your time. And I look forward for the next couple of hours being absolutely exciting. Thank you and Jai Hind.
Thank you, Ms. Reddy. We now have with us Dr. Amit Thakkar, President of Africa Healthcare Federation and Executive Chairman, Africa Health Business. I request Dr. Thakkar to come on screen and address the audience.
Thank you so much. And good morning, good afternoon, wherever you've dialed in from. Honorable Ashwajit, Minister of Health India, Her Excellency Amira Al-Fadil, Commissioner of Social Affairs, Africa Union, representing the African states, Ministers of Health, Ministers representing India and Africa, Ambassadors, Board Members of NATHEALTH, Board Members of Africa Healthcare Federation, Ladies and Gentlemen, all protocols observed. Like my sister Preeta said, you know, best things that could have happened. And this is really an exciting end-of-year collaboration between Africa Healthcare Federation and India. They say crisis leads to an opportunity, and this pandemic is one such crisis that has created some good news at the end of the year, where India and Africa are going to cement in the way they deal with health systems so that billions of livelihoods can be better and we increase our life expectancy. About 18 years ago, in Africa, we realized that the public and private sector should work together to improve maternal health, child health, and improve the infant mortality through engaging the public sector on producing evidence-based policies. Little did we know that when seven companies came together, it would start something that would spur up a singular voice in every country, which became the Federation of Healthcare Voice. Kenya began about 15, 18 years ago, and since then the same model has been used to almost 27 countries in Africa, where these federations engage with the ministries on a regular basis to create a more enabling environment for better health from both public and the private sector. In 2016, it was envisaged by the leaders within the private healthcare in Africa to form an apex body known as the Africa Healthcare Federation, which now speaks with one voice for the non-state health actors engaging across the whole continent. Working together with Africa Union and Africa CDC has given us the thrust to coordinate inter-border collaboration in improving free movement of goods, services, and people. We know that the partnership with India is going to take us to the next level. There isn't a single country in Africa, when we discuss health, that India doesn't feature. You are a great partner to this continent. You are a partner that provides us medical products, pharmaceuticals, largely. You are a continent that provides us services, and you are a continent that we look up to when it comes to sharing of knowledge and sending many of the people in Africa for training in further education, which we'll hear more about later today when we have the white paper being shared. Over the last 3 decades, the growth between our 2 regions has been exponential. It's now very clear that we can become stronger with partnership from India by bringing in the knowledge and sharing the kind of success you've had. And we can make even India stronger by giving certain resources and skills that lie in Africa, especially when it comes to the digital outburst and the youthful population that Geeta mentioned will become even more important as we go towards 2050 and the charting the journey for the Africa we want, Agenda 2063. I am delighted that the Commissioner of Social Affairs and the Minister for Health Ethiopia, who are some of the leaders on this continent, are joining us today to further endorse this relationship between NATHEALTH and Africa Healthcare Federation that will see us working on the task forces that Preeta mentioned. There are so many areas that all of you know that we can work on, but we have carved out 4 regions or 4 task forces that we will focus our energies on for the next 2 to 3 years to make an impact across the whole continent of Africa and India. I am also delighted with the support we've received from Ministry of Health India. We have all witnessed and seen the amazing work that the ministry is doing, and we look forward and extend our hand of partnership as we chart this journey on making sure on this UHC day we sign off the MOU to have a stronger health systems both in India and Africa. Thank you so much to everyone who has been involved in this journey, and thank you to all the viewers. You are all part of this process. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Thakkar. I would now like to invite Sri Rajesh Bhushan, Union Health Secretary, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, for his special address.
Friends from NATHEALTH, friends from Africa Healthcare Federation, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me immense pleasure to speak today at this extremely important event on behalf of Government of India. The collective presence of luminaries today reflects our collective commitment to ensure a healthy and a sustainable world. India and countries of the African continent share very rich and long-standing historical and cultural ties and many commonalities, including a colonial past. We have been engaging with each other regularly since India's independence. In every sphere, we have engaged in trade, in culture, education, and in recent years, we have started our collaborative exercises in energy, information technology, agriculture, and healthcare sectors. Excellencies, as you know, India comprises of 28 states and 8 union territories, and each one of them has a unique and diverse economy and a unique developmental trajectory. This is quite similar to more than 50 nation states which form the African continent. Providing universal and quality healthcare to our population, we face similar challenges. Therefore, the health agenda of both India as well as the countries of African continent is reflective of this dynamic that we are facing. Our countries have been engaging with each other through the India-Africa Forum Summit since the year 2008. India hosted the third India-Africa Forum Summit from October 26 to October 30th in 2015. And if I recall correctly, the summit called for greater cooperation between India and Africa towards sustainable development, agricultural growth, energy access, blue economy, education, skills enhancement, peace and security. The NATHEALTH Africa Health Care Federation collaboration, which has been organized with the specific objective of improved collaboration between all stakeholders in healthcare sector, is an integral part of the overall umbrella of cooperation between India and Africa. Excellencies and friends, it is now almost 11 months since the world's first case of COVID-19 was reported, and large parts of the world are still reeling under the weight of increasing number of new COVID cases, the consequent mortality and morbidity, and the socio-economic consequences of tackling this pandemic. While COVID-19 has had a devastating impact on every aspect of life, the resources which all the countries have dedicated to fight the pandemic have shown the potential that we can create better and resilient health infrastructure, and we can very quickly repurpose our health systems to tackle such challenges. This has lessons going forward. Since January 2020, the Union Government in India has taken several measures for early detection, prevention, and containment of COVID-19, while also tapping this opportunity to strengthen the existing health systems in the country in terms of human resources, facilities, infrastructure, logistics, governance, financing, and information systems. At the outset of COVID-19 pandemic, in our country we had a testing lab, but today we have expanded to 2,200 testing labs, out of which 1,010 are in the private sector, and roughly 1,180 odd are in the government sector. So it speaks volumes of our ability to scale up our healthcare infrastructure, and this is all thanks to the effort not only of the public sector, but also of the private sector entities in the country working together, working hand in hand. As we all know, in order to respond quickly and effectively to COVID-19 pandemic, a broad range of candidate vaccines are being investigated globally using different technologies and platforms. Almost 8 such potential COVID-19 vaccines are under different stages of trial in our country, in India. And the Honorable Prime Minister himself is taking painstaking efforts to ensure the availability of COVID-19 vaccines to the citizens at the earliest. The Honorable Prime Minister has personally interacted with vaccine manufacturers. Some of the major manufacturers with whom the Honorable Prime Minister has interacted are Zydus Cadila from Ahmedabad, Bharat Biotech and Biological E from Hyderabad, Dr. Reddy Lab from Hyderabad, Serum Institute of India and Genova from Pune. He has also encouraged other vaccine manufacturers and our scientists and has applauded their effort and had indicated that in the coming few weeks we would have Indian-made vaccines, which we hope would bring the substantially high price that is being quoted by foreign vaccines to a lower level. Another important area where the country has shown good performance during the pandemic is the integrated disease surveillance, where we have used IT-enabled platforms to track emerging and re-emerging diseases and infections. This IT-enabled platform is something which could be shared with the friendly countries. The Government of India continues to take proactive measures to ensure availability of masks, personal protection equipment kits, isolation and ICU beds, ventilators, and other essential equipment for management of COVID-19. We have now started exporting these equipments abroad, and the Union Government is actively facilitating such exports. COVID-19 pandemic has emphasized the importance of building partnerships, mobilizing the community, strengthening our connect between the public and the private sector, streamlining communication strategies, and strengthening research and development not only in drugs but also in diagnostic kits as well as in vaccines. And I hope that India and Africa, facing similar healthcare issues, will work together, share experiences, and learn from each other on how to tackle and mitigate the increasing threats to people's health. On this occasion, I wish all of you well. I hope that these deliberations will quickly translate into concrete plan of action, and the Union Ministry of Health, as well as the state governments and their departments of health, would be more than willing and eager to be part of this friendship and collaborative exercise between NATHEALTH and Africa Healthcare Federation. I once again wish you well. Namaste.
Thank you, sir, for your remarks and great insights. We are honored to have His Excellency Alan Tashiha Ulmaria, the Dean of African Missions in India, join us today.
Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, at the beginning, I wish to express my sincere thanks and appreciation to Ms. Rita Reddy, President of NATHEALTH and Vice Chairperson, Apollo Hospitals, and also Africa Healthcare Federation, HHF, for organizing this special event focusing on strengthening South-South collaboration between Africa and India healthcare towards universal health coverage. My thanks go also to the senior representatives of the esteemed healthcare institution in India present this afternoon. The health sector assumes special importance in India-Africa development cooperation. It is a major component of the broad-ranging collaborative effort initiated under the rubric of India-Africa cooperation in social development and capacity building. In this regard, I would like to thank this opportunity to hear various initiatives taken by the Government of India towards improving healthcare across the African continent by sharing management strategies and training webinars by Indian health experts to train African healthcare professionals. Further, the Indian Council of Medical Research had initiated and strengthened the cooperation in the health sector by establishing an Indian Africa Health Service collaborative platform. An MOU was signed in India Africa Health Science Corporation between the Indian Council of Medical Research in the African Union on 27 March 2019 in New Delhi in order to cooperate in the areas of research and development, capacity building, health services, pharmaceutical trade, and manufacturing capabilities for drugs and diagnosis, which will be a crucial milestone in India-Africa healthcare collaboration. Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, as you all know, the spread of the novel coronavirus is certainly the most devastating global crisis in the Second World War, affecting the healthcare system across the African continent, which has been fragile even before the pandemic, along with an additional burden of higher number of cases in HIV, malaria, Ebola, and the malnourished strain, among others. As the world grapples with this pandemic, it is the need of the hour that India and the African countries reinforce collaborating, control the outbreak of the pandemic, and to mitigate its long-term effect. During this pandemic, Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, had telephone conversation with many of his African counterparts over the past few months and has conveyed India's full support for the joint African efforts against the virus. India has also provided medical aid to 25 countries in Africa in the form of supplies of essential drugs, including hydroxychloroquine or HSQ, and 16 other essential drugs, including life-saving antibiotics. Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, COVID-19 has created challenges for African countries, but also offers many opportunities. Despite the fact that the continent appears to be weathering the pandemic in terms of broad health outcomes, the challenge of adequate health infrastructures in most African countries persist and need to be addressed. As Africa continues to grow, economically improving the health of people on the continent remains the key to unlocking its development and wealth. Consequently, the African governments have expressed their willing to develop the health sector, medical cooperation, and infrastructure capacities. In this regard, the African governments are trying to create more business-friendly environment by controlling the prices and lowering import restrictions, hence encouraging the domestic pharmaceuticals and medicines manufacturing companies. In this sense, this main prediction for the African healthcare market in next years is that the market will embrace technologies and innovations that can improve efficiency and access to healthcare, like, for example, e-health. In the coming years, more and more number of investors and corporate houses will invest in the healthcare industry in Africa. Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I believe that India has an intrinsic interest in partnering in this Africa's health progress. The two parties can give a strong impetus to South-South cooperation in the health sector, as well as in addressing and overcoming the related challenges in the context of the current pandemic, like digitization and the connectivity. India needs to explore investment opportunities in the development of facilities in Africa's health sector and support African economies achieve their sustainable development goals, mainly universal health coverage. It is also important to assist African countries to acquire and get the vaccine against COVID-19 at a reasonable price. India's efforts in this regard could be highly appreciated. Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you why India needs to partner with the African countries in the health system. By investing in Africa's healthcare, India will safeguard the respected and trusted image of its healthcare system in the minds of Africans. Therefore, investing in medical training institutions in Africa will certainly ensure an African human capital that will be able to support and succeed India's investments in medical infrastructure in Africa. Indeed, the transfer of relevant technologies, the exchange of data, statistics and experiences in managing health crises should be also in the heart of the healthcare cooperation between India and Africa. In such a context, the private sector has a significant role to play. I believe that India today is not only the pharmacy of the world, but also a leading healthcare provider for the world. A video conference with all African countries to explore further cooperation may be considered. Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I think that this conference is a landmark of its kind between India and Africa healthcare actors, which will surely chart a new course to bring in significant path-breaking changes in the healthcare trajectory of India and Africa. I believe that the discussions in this webinar will highlight the need for a strategy to increase cooperation in building our healthcare infrastructure, which includes cooperation through India's lines of credit to African nations and the engagement through the public-private partnerships more cooperation in capacity building and the training of medical personnel. I firmly believe this pandemic has the merit to let us rethink the health cooperation and redefine the priorities to ensure co-development between India and Africa. I congratulate both AHF and the NATHEALTH for bringing with them the industry support behind this to make national program successful while opening the doors for universal health care. Both Africa and India should continue to build links with each other in numerous fields in a mutually beneficial relationship as equal partners. I want to conclude by thanking you all for your kind attention and the organizers for the wonderful job they have done to ensure the success of this important webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your insights, encouraging words and support. I am pleased to inform you all that we are being broadcasted live through our media partner Musix, helping us reach thousands of viewers. We have with us Honorable Dr. Leah Thaddeuser, Minister of Health Ethiopia. I request Dr. Thaddeuser to come on screen and deliver the keynote address.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I am honored to address this important symposium and would like to express my appreciation to the organizers, the Healthcare Federation of India and the African Healthcare Federation. India and Africa have a long-standing history of collaboration on several fronts, and we must renew our commitment now to further strengthen our collaborations as we strive to achieve universal health coverage globally. The current global health outlook is sobering, especially for the developing world. The COVID-19 pandemic has exposed our weaknesses and has challenged even the most advanced health systems in strong economies. More than ever, this pandemic has shown us how interconnected our world is through everything from health delivery to supply chains, travel, tourism. Our well-being and economies rely on our collaboration and moving forward together. It has brought to the forefront the importance of solidarity, resilient health systems, and the urgency for universal health coverage. In Ethiopia, solidarity has been our primary strategy to minimize the direct and indirect impacts of COVID-19 through enhanced community mobilization activities and collective efforts to save lives and livelihoods. We took a multi-sectoral approach in establishing COVID-19 task teams to strengthen our collective response with the whole-of-government approach. The collaborative efforts of the whole-of-government, starting from the National Ministerial Committee chaired by His Excellency Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed and subcommittees led by sector ministers coordinating different areas including logistics, communication, resource mobilization, and much more. The business community also played a crucial role in the fight against COVID-19 through generous financial assistance and donation of private property for public use, while industrial parks shifted their production to produce much needed PPE supplies. The professional community from academia, professional associations and researchers both in Ethiopia and abroad also rose to the occasion and were collectively involved in advising the government, resource mobilizing and joining forces to promote public awareness and advocacy to decision makers. Our partners have also worked on our side by providing all needed support. Moreover, the public health management systems at national and subnational levels coordinated all efforts to improve the preparedness of the health sector to prevent or reduce the public health consequences of the outbreak and also of other diseases. the core capacities to prevent, detect, respond, and mitigate public health emergencies have been improving through this pandemic. Furthermore, enhanced mobilization and actively engaging communities, health extension workers, partners, and the private sector was done nationwide to minimize this direct and indirect impact of the pandemic. The pandemic has also brought to the forefront the need for countries to reverse and build resilient health systems through collaborative efforts and partnership with the global community, including the private sector. Ethiopia has developed a 10-year health sector roadmap and a 5-year health sector transformation plan, and private sector engagement has been identified as one strategic pillar in achieving both the 5- and 10-year plan of the health sector. The private sector will play an important role in a wide range of activities, including service delivery, production of medicines and medical supplies, supply chain management, health financing, health information system, human resource development, administration, and capacity building to strengthen the health system. The government of Ethiopia has issued a public-private partnership proclamation to increase the participation of the private sector for the realization of the country's development objectives, including the infrastructure and healthcare system. I also believe the meaningful participation of the private sector is the next frontier for inclusive economic development. Guided by the broader agenda of the government, the Ministry of Health has also developed the Public-Private Partnership in Health Implementation Guideline with the following main objectives. One is to improve access to quality and affordable health services. The second is to create effective platforms to nurture untapped opportunities and facilitate the exchange of technology, knowledge, and practices between the public and private sectors. The third is availing comprehensive tertiary health care services and attraction of medical tourism. The fourth being encouraging the private sector for high-end diagnostic services. And the final one being encouraging the private sector investment in pharmaceutical manufacturing. Moreover, the government has developed a 10-year strategic plan of action for pharmaceutical manufacturing to improve access to locally produced essential medicines and the creation of research and development-based industry that would effectively contribute to skilled human resource development and to the growing knowledge economy. Current incentives by the Ethiopian government for local production include income tax exemptions for formulation or final medicine and API manufacturers, use of long-term procurement guarantee frameworks to incentivize strategic investors and promote exports, facilitation of access to finance, domestic import protection by giving 25% price preference in the Ethiopian Pharmaceutical Supply Agency contracts, and the Industrial Park Development Corporation has also dedicated a newly constructed industrial park for private pharmaceutical manufacturers. The government has taken monumental and sustainable steps to engage the private sector in the range of fields and provides its support to see them thrive and contribute to a healthier and safer Ethiopia. India and Africa's future is closely interlinked. Our private sectors, entrepreneurs can further strengthen our partnership, creating a win-win scenario. And Ethiopia looks forward to a closer and stronger collaboration between Africa and India. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Thaddeuson. I now invite Dr. Daniel Bersa, Chief of Staff, Ministry of Health, Ethiopia, to share a few words with us.
Thank you, Your Excellencies, Your Excellency Minister of Health and Family Welfare of India, Dear Excellency Commissioner Amira, Dear Excellencies, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to join this high-level India-Africa Health Symposium, and it's also an opportunity to talk about the India Health, India-Africa Health collaboration that we had. And I believe that this symposium is an important step towards strengthening partnership with the private sector, both in Africa and India. And this symposium also will mark an important moment to acknowledge our collective responsibility and continued commitment to the South collaboration between Africa and India healthcare towards universal health coverage. The health, social, and economic impact of the recent COVID-19 pandemic have highlighted the importance of building resilient health system to better protect communities from naturally occurring and human-caused threats. And now, the agenda of UHC is very relevant and timely than before. Ethiopia has built a public health management system at national and sub-national levels, as Her Excellency Dr. Leah mentioned before, and we had a lot of activities done in a whole of government approach to respond COVID-19 approach. And in the fight against COVID-19, we witnessed that the private sector has played an extremely exemplary role in giving like public their property, even their private property for public use, financial contribution, in-kind donation, and direct service delivery for patients affected with COVID-19. Factories was also repurposed to produce much-needed PPEs, sanitizers, and laboratory essentials. And the private sector, in collaboration with foreign companies in Ethiopia, established the second COVID-19 detection test kit in Africa. And this showed that if both private and public collaborate, we can avert like pandemic, like the upcoming pandemic and the current pandemic, like COVID-19. But despite all the efforts and success, the overall health system has been overstretched in responding to the pandemic and faced shortage of critical medical supplies, ICU beds, testing facility, human resource, which in turn affects the overall essential and non-COVID health service. Even the pandemic has proved that developing countries like us have many opportunities for revising and building resilient health system through collaborative efforts and partnership with global community, including the private sector. We believe that in the next coming year, private sector is the untapped potential to finance health and non-health sector in Africa. And this is untouched area which the government should look into it. And as Dr. Leah mentioned, Ethiopia has a clear new public-private partnership proclamation to increase the involvement and participation of private sector for realization of country's development objectives, including infrastructure and healthcare system. And also we have like clear public-private partnership in health implementation guideline at the Ministry of Health. And also we have just developed 10 years strategic plan and action for pharmaceutical manufacturing to improve access to Ethiopian people to locally produce good quality essential medicines. So currently, only 20% of all the essential and vital medicines are produced in country. 80% of them are imported. So there is a huge potential for private sectors to invest in this area. And the government of Ethiopia put different incentives to encourage private sectors in investing in this untapped area. And finally, we'd like to reaffirm the commitment of the Ethiopian government on the behalf of the Ministry of Health to support the private sector and investors for a healthier and safer Africa and Ethiopia and achieve sustainable development. I thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Daniel. Now I would request Sri V. Muralidharan, Honorable Minister of State for External Affairs, Government of India, to address the audience.
Dr. Harshvardhan ji, Honorable Union Minister for Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, and Chairman, Executive Board of the World Health Organization, His Excellency Dr. Leah Tadese, Minister of Health, Government of Ethiopia, His Excellency Amira Al-Fadil, Commissioner for Social Affairs Africa Union Commission, His Excellency Alem Sahai Volmariam, the Dean of African Missions in India, Africa, Sri Rajesh Bhushan, Secretary, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Ms. Preetha Reddy, President, NATHEALTH, distinguished participants of the conference, ladies and gentlemen, Namaskaram. At the outset, I wish to congratulate NATHEALTH for organizing this conference. India enjoys a special relationship with the countries of Africa because of our shared civilizational values, anti-colonial struggle, and age-old people-to-people ties. After independence of India, our relationship with African countries have grown manifold and matured into an enduring partnership, both in the regional and global context. Therefore, I consider this subject very timely, since both India and the fellow developing countries of Africa are facing the common threat of COVID-19. COVID-19 pandemic, not only to the life but also livelihood of their people. Ladies and gentlemen, currently we are all witnessing a major health crisis in the form of COVID-19 pandemic. It has affected most of our established practices, norms and regulations, and has emerged as the biggest disruptor. The primary impact of this disruption has been economic. That is why our Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji has said that in our fight against the pandemic, we should focus both on Jaan and Jahan, that is Jaan bhi, Jahan bhi. The pandemic has underlined the importance of ensuring supply chain diversification and resilience, especially in the healthcare sector. It has made countries reassess their health infrastructure requirements, focus on availability and affordability of medicines, as well as development of reliable supply chains for critical healthcare products. The world has also realized that it needs more trusted and capable players now. India has the willingness and capability to act as a responsible partner, as we are guided by the ancient philosophy of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, or the world is one family. Even during the pandemic, India has been able to rapidly increase its pharmaceutical production to respond to growing global demands. We supplied medicines to 150 countries, including 35 African nations, deployed medical teams to our friends in distress. Because of our proactive assistance to the countries in need, India has come to be seen as the pharmacy of the world. Not only that, India also took the lead in engaging the world leaders for evolving a coordinated response to the pandemic. A virtual conference of SAARC leaders on jointly dealing with the pandemic was hosted by India at Prime Minister's initiative. Our Prime Minister also encouraged the early convening of the virtual G20 summit. He subsequently attended the online NAM summit, and most recently the virtual global vaccine summit, where India pledged $15 million to Gavi, the international vaccine alliance. We have also pledged our capabilities and production capacities to global efforts for developing vaccines and other treatments at low cost. We feel that it is important to strengthen efforts aimed at the development of an equitable and universal access to diagnostic tools, treatments and vaccines. India stands ready to collaborate with the world, especially Africa, towards this objective. Ladies and gentlemen, Government of India also sees health services as an important vector in India's engagement with Africa. We understand and appreciate the priorities of our African partners. We are aware and have taken note of the Agenda 2063, aimed to achieve a more prosperous Africa through inclusive and sustainable development. The main element of Sustainable Development Goal 3 and of Agenda 2063 is to ensure good health and wellness of all citizens by 2063 through access to affordable and quality health care services. India too is committed to the SDGs, and its commitment to universal access to good quality health care as outlined in the National Health Policy of 2070 has been factored into the India-Africa Development Partnership, especially in those areas where Indian experience and remedies could be most suitably adapted to Africa's healthcare needs. In order to carry forward the strategic vision of the India-Africa Forum Summit 3 through a structured partnership in the health sector, my ministry, in partnership with the Indian Council of Medical Research or the ICMR, held the first India-Africa Health Sciences Meet in 2016 in New Delhi. Following this meeting, ICMR has taken the initiative to strengthen cooperation by establishing an India-Africa Health Sciences Collaborative Platform. An MOU has also been signed between the African Union and ICMR and India, that is ICMR, in March 2019 to cooperate in the areas of research and development, capacity building, health services, pharmaceutical trade and manufacturing capabilities for drugs and diagnostics. I believe implementing this important MOU will be a crucial milestone in India-Africa healthcare collaboration, which will be mutually beneficial. We had also planned to hold in the year 2020 an India-Africa Health Ministers meeting with a special focus on the treatment and control of tuberculosis, an invisible but deadly scourge of the developing world. But this meeting could not be held because of the pandemic, and I very much hope that we succeed in holding this meeting at the early possible occasion, since I believe that we have much to learn from each other, and India is certainly committed to sharing with our African partners the innovative expertise that we have developed in treating this disease in a focused and effective manner. Ladies and gentlemen, Ministry of External Affairs launched the Pan Africa E-Network project in 2019 with a project cost of 542 crore rupees. The project envisaged the setting up of an e-network connecting Indian institutions with 53 countries of Africa through satellite and fiber optic links, and providing tele-education and telemedicine services to them. The project has been commissioned in 48 countries that have signed the agreement with Telecommunications Consultants India Limited, that is TCIL, for participating in it. The first phase of this program was over in 2017, and now we are offering 1,500 scholarships over a period of 5 years through the second phase of the project, renamed as E-Vidya Bharati and E-Arogya Bharati Network Project, that is E-VBAB. The telemedicine project has become a milestone in the India-Africa relations. Through this mechanism, medical practitioners at the patient end location in Africa can consult online Indian medical specialists on various disciplines and specialities selected by African Union for its member states. Any doctor from any of the remote locations in Africa can refer the patient's medical records to the specialists in the Indian super specialty hospitals. African patients can also have a telemedicine video session for live diagnosis and advice by the doctors on a scheduled time in association with the provider. Super specialty hospital and the receiver and the remote telemedicine center. Patient consultation centers have already been set up in 12 Indian super speciality hospitals, including All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Ladies and gentlemen, I see this summit jointly organized by NATHEALTH and Africa Healthcare Federation as a private sector effort to engage, collaborate, deliberate.